Go ahead and introduce the next speaker. As you look at the slide on the screen, obviously the person who's going to speak to you is not Justin Gordon. I think that's probably obvious. Justin called me a couple of days ago and said that he could not be here for another reason. So he said, I'm sending a person much better than me to make this presentation. So we're privileged to have with us today Tamara Smith. She is the Coordinator for Education and Enforcement with the Attorney General's Office. I'll just turn it over to Karen.
Good afternoon. As everyone sort of makes their way back to their seat, as you said, for the Open Records Division, I handle both education and enforcement. And I like to say I enjoy being out here speaking to you on the education side much more than I enjoy sending you nasty letters and threatening to file lawsuits against you. So hopefully when we learn everything today, I won't have to do that. So Jenny covered the Open Meetings Act. The other act we're covering today is the Public Information Act, which is Chapter 552 of the Government Code. So our training, as Jenny said, and as you now all have the handouts, the code for both certificates is on there. And so these are the topics that we will be covering today and that we do cover pursuant to the statute. Section 552.012 is the section that says you have to have that training certificate and take this training, and these are the topics we're going to cover. We're going to cover the background and the legal requirements of the Public Information Act. We're going to cover the applicability of the Public Information Act. So I think most of you are here today because you know that the Public Information Act applies to you, and not for fun, but we're going to go over who it applies to. Also, the procedures and requirements regarding complying with the Public Information Act. The role of my office in the Public Information Act, we do provide rulings, and we're going to go into a little bit more about what we do. And then, sort of just as Jenny did, the last thing we're going to cover is the penalties and other consequences for not doing everything we covered today. So this is sort of the first look at my office's role in the Public Information Act. In addition to coming out and educating people and handling complaints and those types of issues in the hotline, the majority of what the Open Records Division does is issue open records letter rulings. And so this chart is just sort of to illustrate a couple purposes. One, when I'm about to tell you all the requirements and things that you need to do to get a ruling, that a lot of people are doing it. Two, you're not alone. In addition to, I believe it was just over 28,000 rulings that we did last year, we also took 9,000 hotline calls. So when she put that hotline number up, call us. We will answer your questions. You are not alone in this. We will help you through it. Okay. That being said, I start the official portion of this presentation with the first section in the Act. And there's a reason that we do this. And it's not because I just like reading the Public Information Act over and over again. It's because it's actually very important to how we issue all of those rulings and how we interpret the Public Information Act. So, not going to read the whole thing, but definitely that bolded portion there. It says, it is the policy of this state that each person is entitled, unless otherwise expressly provided by law, at all times, to complete information about the affairs of the government and the official acts of public officials and employees. Okay? So that's important. It says that the public is entitled to this information. Then we go to the second section up there, and it says that this chapter shall be liberally construed in favor of granting a request for information. So we are going to talk about some exceptions to the Act. We are going to talk about things that are confidential. But if ever we get to this point where we're like, we're not sure if this exception applies, this is what the legislature has told us to do in the very first section of the Act. It's liberally construed in favor of granting a request. Okay? So this is, like I said, we start there because everything going forward, that's what's on our mind. This is what we're looking back to. Okay, so what is public information? So it's sort of, I always like to say, as lawyers and a lot of the legislature, we like to throw a lot of terms out there, and then we like to define those terms and then we like to give you exceptions to those terms and rules. And so you'll sort of see that throughout the presentation thing. I'm going to give you the basic definitions. We're going to go over some basic rules and then some exceptions to the basic rules. Maybe some exceptions to the exceptions, who knows. So, public information means information that's written, collected, produced, assembled, or maintained. Okay? And then there's three different things here. So it's in the connection with official business, and it's by a governmental body. That one's pretty easy. You're there at your office, you're there at your meeting, you created information. The governmental body is actually creating it. That one's pretty simple. That's subject to the Public Information Act. Two, it's for a governmental body, and the governmental body owns the information or has a right of access to it. One of the examples of this is an attorney. You have outside counsel. Your outside counsel is obviously creating documents on your behalf. So that person doesn't have to actually be a member of the governmental body. What you don't want to do as part of the complaints process, because I have had this happen, disclaimer, is call me and say that your attorney signed a settlement agreement on your behalf, you have no right of access to it. Not gonna believe you. Most of those things that your attorney is doing on your behalf, you have a right of access to. Okay, number three is important, and that's by an individual officer or employee of the governmental body that's in their official capacity and the information pertains to official business. So where this one comes in the most common is going to be your electronic communications. So for example, I always like to, especially when I'm out on the road speaking here, I have my cell phone with me. This is my personal cell phone. I don't have one that the Attorney General pays for. So I could have sent two text messages while Jenny was speaking. One, to my husband saying, what's for dinner tonight? That, clearly not subject to the Public Information Act, not requested. But if I had sent another one back to the office asking or even directing, I do supervise our hotline, giving someone instructions or telling them to do something, that is by an individual employee of the Attorney General's office, but I created it as part of my official business and on behalf of that governmental body. So that's just something to keep in mind. It's, yes, I think everyone typically thinks of, I'm sitting there at my computer at work typing away at a document, and that's clearly subject, but also outside of that. Some things can be subject if they pertain to official business. Okay, this last part's what we just covered, and it's just that if it's an electronic communication, that's still subject. I think going forward, we get more and more questions about these electronic communications. So for example, because we have this slide here, go over, you may have this, I have this text message. We do get calls on the hotline. Someone's like, well, that's on my phone. How do I give me? Now we got a request for it. I want all communications that Tamara sent while she was out of the office on Tuesday. So what do we do about that? The answer is it's better to think about that now. I've seen people either forward it by email, take a screenshot, do what you have to do. Just make sure you're following the act regarding those electronic communications. Have a policy in place. Okay, so official business, I've used that term. Like I said, we're lawyers, we like to define all these terms. What does that mean? That means any matter over which the governmental body has authority, administrative duty, or advisory duties. So again, we do run that hotline as part of the act, and so if I was dealing with something that we had authority to do, that's gonna be official business. Okay, forms of public information. Basically, the point of this slide is any way you can record information counts as information. So we have paper, film, tape, magnetic, optical, or solid state storage. That means all of your hard drives, your CD, your hard drive, that type of thing. And then we also go on to audio and video recording, photographs, maps, emails. All of those things are subject to the act. I know Jenny joked about not using cassette tapes anymore, which is true. I think most people have moved away from them. I say most because I do still deal with some governmental bodies using dial-up internet and cassette tapes. They exist. It's Texas. It's a very big state. But again, just like the text messages, you may have a map. You may have a map that's 40 by 60 inches that is subject to the act, and there needs to be a way to reproduce that if someone requests it. You know, on the opposite side, we do also deal with microfilm and microfiche. So we go from old school all the way up to new stuff and making sure that your governmental body has a way to provide that information to the public if it's requested. Okay, so this part, now the definition we're on is what is a governmental body? And again, I joked at the beginning, but I think everyone is not here for fun on a Tuesday afternoon, but because you know that you fall under that. Some of the other types of governmental bodies are state agencies, cities and counties, school districts, utility districts. It's agencies that are funded with public monies. And the one exception there at the bottom is it does not include the judiciary. They have their own separate rules and laws. Okay, so now that we've gone over what information is subject, which is essentially all the information you have, and the fact that you are a subject, we look at what triggers the Public Information Act. And in order to trigger the Public Information Act, you have to have a request, okay? So, what is a public information request? Those first two bullet points are the only two requirements. It needs to be in writing, and it must ask for information in existence at the time of the request. That's it. We're gonna go through an exercise in a minute where we look at some samples, but keep those in mind. That's it. In writing, and ask for information that existed at the time of the request, okay? Inherent in that is that you don't have to create new documents, you don't have to answer legal questions or do legal research, okay? Also though, there's no magic words. It does not have to say this is a public information request. And the example I like to use for that is with those 28,000 rulings last year, I believe we received something like 50,000 pieces of mail, okay? We went through every one of those pieces of mail timely to make sure that they didn't have Public Information Act requests. Because we may receive a brief from a third party that's 15 pages long, and somewhere in page 9, they say, oh, by the way, can I have a copy of the other third party's brief? In writing, asks for something we have. So just keep that in mind in going through your communications. Also, they don't need to label it, typed or handwritten. Going along with the dial-up internet, I do still receive quite a bit of mail from people that's just handwritten. It sort of scares me when I learned that they're not teaching cursive in all the schools anymore, because I do receive things that are written in cursive, and I hope those attorneys will be able to read it someday. You can't require the use of a specific form. That doesn't mean you can't have one. You absolutely can have a form available for a member of the public, but if they do not want to use it, you can't force them to. And that's sort of come up in the complaints process when I've had a governmental body that has an online form, which most people found very convenient. However, I think it limited you to 3,000 words, something that you would think would be long enough for a Public Information Act request. One requester didn't think so. So they couldn't force him to use that form. If he wanted to submit his 15-page, single-spaced request, they had to accept it. Okay. So what do you, you know, given those requirements, given that those requirements are very narrow in writing and ask for information, what do you do if the request is not clear or unduly broad? So, that first bullet point, that's the one thing you can't ask the requester. You cannot ask the requester why they want the information. That does not mean we discourage you from talking to requesters. Because I always tell people on the hotline, remember, you as the governmental body know what information you have. The requester does not. A lot of times, some of the complaints I get can be resolved by explaining to the requester that they're asking for something that that governmental body just doesn't have or have a need for. So just keep that in mind. You can, however, ask the requester to clarify or narrow their request. So if they ask for, I want this type of report, and you have no idea what they're talking about because you have no report that has that name, but you do have two similar reports, absolutely you can ask them to clarify their request. Okay? If, in this court case up here, if you do so, we're about to get into some deadlines that you have to act under the Public Information Act. If you ask for clarification or narrowing in good faith, then your request is now considered received on the day that you receive that response. So when we go into, like I said, the deadlines in a minute, that's sort of important to keep in mind. Okay, now we're gonna look at some sample requests. This is audience participation. I'm gonna wanna see a thumbs up or a thumbs down from everyone. Let me know if you think this is a request under the Public Information Act. So what if the request said, I want John Smith's personnel file pursuant to the U.S. Freedom of Information Act, the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, and the open records laws of the European Union. Okay, I see mostly thumbs down. Okay, guys, remember, what were the two requirements? Is it in writing? Yes. Does it ask for something I have? I have John Smith's personnel file. Yes. So this is a request under the Public Information Act. I don't care that after that, they went on to cite a bunch of laws that don't apply. You know, obviously the laws of the European Union don't apply to you. But if it's in writing and asks for something you have, that's a request. Okay, what about this one? This is one of our handwritten examples. So you received this scrawled across a napkin. That's what I say. It says, I want all records involved in report number 225-436-96. Signed, Bob Scroll. Okay, thumbs up or thumbs down again? Okay, I see some thumbs up here. Yes, this one's a request. You know, even if this person walked into your office and handed you this on a napkin, scroll, still a request. It's in writing and asks for information. Okay, let's look at this one. The request, still in writing, says, I want any and all documents pertaining to Jane Smith, including but not limited to communications sent or received by her in the last 5 years. Okay, thumbs up or thumbs down, everyone. Okay, I see mostly thumbs up, a few thumbs down. This is a request. This is definitely a candidate where you may want to narrow or clarify it, but it is still in writing and asks for information that you would then be under your deadlines to respond to. Okay, what if it said, I want any and all communications Jane Smith sends or receives over the next 30 days starting tomorrow. No, I heard some no's and thumbs down. So this one, right. Even if it's in writing, this one doesn't ask for information that existed at the time I made the request. So there's no such thing. We call them standing requests. There's no such thing. If I got a complaint on this, I would tell them this information didn't exist on the date you made the request. It's not valid. Okay, so what if it said, I want all of Jane Smith's evaluations because I'm considering going into business with her and would like to know about her personal background. Okay, see mostly thumbs up. Yes, this is a request. I said you couldn't ask the requester why they wanted the information. However, the requester can volunteer that information, and oftentimes they do. It doesn't affect whether or not you need to respond. The example we used to have up here was, I want Jane Smith's evaluations and personnel files. I'm considering asking her out on a date. Again, whatever reason they volunteer for wanting the information doesn't matter, as long as they're asking for information. Yes?
I'm confused. What about the Privacy Act? How does that be personally protected information gathered?
Okay. So for everyone else, the question was, what about the Privacy Act? There's common law privacy and several other exceptions that may apply, which we're about to go through in a minute. But it still, so there's always, I like to say on the hotline, there's two steps to this. We're on step one, which is it a request and is the information subject to the Public Information Act? Step two is, can we withhold any of it under exceptions? And we are going to get there. There is typically not her whole personnel file or evaluations, but definitely some information in there. Okay, so what about this one? This one says, how do you determine whether to file an appeal? What are the legal requirements to appeal a court's ruling? Also, do you think I should appeal my case? Yeah, I see thumbs down. That's correct. For the most part, the only exception I like to point out in this one, again, I'm an attorney, we throw all those exceptions. If your governmental body actually had a written policy for determining whether or not to file an appeal, then that may be responsive. So just because it's in question form doesn't necessarily exclude it. A more clear example would be if I said, do you have the most recent report on, this well? Okay, just because I phrased it in the form of a question, if you have that report, it could still be a request. Yes? Records of the judiciary are exempt. And since none of you are actually members of the judiciary, at least in this function, I don't know if you hold two roles, those wouldn't be records of the judiciary. But again, that part that's asking about court requirements, you're probably not going to have anything on that anyway. And the last question is definitely legal advice that you don't have to answer. So you're not going to have to answer it, not because it's court records, but because they're asking for legal advice and legal research that you don't have to do. Okay.
Can I put you back here, Dan?
Oh.
Can you charge, if it's going to take 3 or 4 hours or half a day, can you charge them for the time of the personnel doing the work?
Can you repeat the question?
I will repeat the question. So the question had to do with charges, and can you charge? So say we go back to this one where it asks for any and all documents that she sent for the past 5 years, and you asked for clarification, and they said, I think my request's pretty clear. I want everything she sent for 5 years. Yes, the short answer is yes, you may charge. The long answer is I do a whole separate presentation on cost that's longer than this one, and I do our cost hotline. I'm gonna show you some resources at the end. The short answer is yes. You are allowed, the general rule is when providing copies, you can charge for materials, labor, and overhead. That's the short answer. If you have some specific questions, we can absolutely chat later. Like I said, it's a whole separate deal. Okay, let's go back to where we were. So emails and faxes. So we talked about receiving written requests, that a request is in writing. If you have designated an email or fax, so for example, ours for the Attorney General Office is publicrecords@texasattorneygeneral.gov, or a new one, we have a new email extension. Anyway, that's the old one. But that is now the only email address that we can receive requests at. So if someone emails me to tamara.smith, then that's not considered a valid request since we have designated an email address and fax number. So just sort of important to keep that in mind. Make things simple on yourself and designate those. And then if requests, in that case, like I said, if they're sent to other email or fax addresses, then those aren't considered valid requests and you wouldn't need to respond to them. Okay. How do requesters know that? We get that question a lot, so you're like, okay, we made this public record at Texas Attorney General. How does a requester know that that's where they need to send the request? So in this case, that would go along with this other information on a sign. There is a sign that is required by every governmental body to be posted. We have that sign, if you are not doing so, on our website for you to print. But that sign does contain the requester's rights, the responsibilities of governmental bodies, again, this is a notice for the requesters, and then the procedures for inspecting and obtaining copies. So again, if you have further questions about that, we can chat and show exactly where to find it on our website if you need to post that. Okay. So now that we've gone through, I believe at this time, all the definitions, so you now have identified a request. You know you have records subject to the Act. You got a request, so now the question is, now what? What do I have to do to actually comply with the Public Information Act? So, the Act says you must promptly produce the records for for inspection, duplication, or both, or ask for a decision from the Attorney General about whether or not the information is accepted. Okay. So we have this slide where we give you those two options, and then, as I said, we're going to give you a bunch of exceptions. So, but I do want that first bullet point to stick in everyone's mind. Notice it says promptly produce. It does not say wait until the 10th business day to produce. It does say promptly. Okay, and so what does promptly mean? Promptly means as soon as possible under the circumstances, within a reasonable time, without delay. So again, it means if I call you because I received a request and say, hey, this requester said that they requested the report that the board discussed last night. It's sitting on your desk. Why have you now waited 8 days? Don't delay, is what it's saying. However, if the requester is asking for something that you're required to go search for and you have multiple requests in front, then absolutely treat them in the order you received them. And it's a case-by-case certification. It's not meant to scare anyone, but again, don't purposefully delay is what you want to take away from that. And if you cannot produce the information within 10 business days after the date that you received the request, then you must certify that fact in writing and tell the requester a date, hour, that reasonably it would be available. So this comes into situations only where you are releasing the information, because this provision in section 552.221 doesn't change the deadlines we're about to talk about for Attorney General decision. But if it's something that the requester has asked for and it's in multiple locations and you have to wait for people to get you information and it's going to take longer than 10 business days, then all this section says is send them a letter. Send them a letter that says, we did receive your request. However, you know, you can include as much information you want in there about we have to go get it from our storage facility, and it will be available. So for example, if we got the request today and I knew what we had to do, it'll be available March 30th, you know, by close of business. That's what that says. Okay, how much time do you have to request an Attorney General's ruling? So this is where it's actually 10 business days, not promptly. So if you wish to withhold information from the requester, so this is where we got the question about the personnel files. There's something private in there that you need a decision on. That decision must be requested within 10 business days. Unless, here's where we get into some exceptions to the exceptions, it's unless you have a previous determination. So there are two types of previous determinations. Do you like our creative titles here? We have type one and type two. Type one, that's the most common. That is where you have a decision from us for that exact information and none of the law, facts, or circumstances have changed. So you got that request for Jane Smith's personnel file. You asked for a ruling. We marked it and sent it back to you. And then 2 months later, you get a request for that same personnel file. So as long as everything's the same, there's been no new evaluation or any change, then you can still rely on that first ruling. Trust me, with 28,000 rulings, we don't feel like issuing multiple rulings on the exact same information, okay? Type two. Type two is applicable to, we have all governmental bodies, some governmental bodies, but what it is going to be, is going to be applicable to a specific type of information or category of information. I always like to say, all of our rulings are available on our website. All of our ORDs and all of our ORLs are all on our website. If you're looking at one and you're trying to figure out, can I use this as a previous determination and not request a ruling, type two will tell you it is a previous determination. When you are reading it, it will say, this is a previous determination. And in the case of, we're going to look at, this is the most common example. It's Open Records Decision 684. If you go read 684 on our website, it says, this is a previous determination issued to all governmental bodies, and you may withhold, or must withhold in this case, and these are the information in there. So if you want to see an example of one of those, that's the easiest one to go pull up on our website. And so what 684 says is that if you get a request, so say you got the request for the whole personnel file, and in that personnel file you had their direct deposit authorization, their I-9, and an email address of a member of the public, their private email address. So you could withhold all of those without asking for a ruling. You would just tell the requester, here's what we're releasing, we're withholding this information pursuant to ORD 684. That's how that would work. Okay. So you've got your request, you've scoured our website, you find no previous determinations that apply, and you now need to request a ruling. So what do you need to send to us? What do you need to do? So the procedures are found in 552, 301, and 305. Not later than the 10th business day, you need to ask us for a ruling and state the exceptions that apply. You need to notify the requester that you've asked for a ruling. You also need to provide the requester a copy of your letter to us and notify any third parties who you think may have a proprietary interest. So that last one comes into play most commonly in proposal situations. You have a proposal from a third party, so notify them that you received the request. Notifying the requester in writing, that can be done as part of your regular letter. You know, you may put a note on the bottom, note requester, by copy of this letter, we're informing you of this. So we've seen it always. We've seen two separate letters, as long as all those requirements get in there. So then, once you send us those things, you can do all of this in the first letter by the 10th business day, but if you need more time, then you have until the 15th business day to get us this additional information. So in the 10th business day, you just need to tell us, we think 552.101 with common law privacy and 117 apply for a personnel file. But then on the 15th business day, you need to provide us comments explaining why you think those apply. You also need to send us a copy of the written request for information. We need to see what you received from the requester, a signed statement as to the date that you received the request. Again, that can be in your letter. Assuming your letter is signed, you can tell us in your letter. Also, a copy. And we do have there not your original, because that has been an issue in the past. We do not want your original documents. Yes, our floor is very secure, but we've had people call and ask for them back. We have 45 business days to issue a ruling. We don't want your original documents. We take very good care of your copies, but please send us a copy. Label the copy of the information to indicate which exceptions apply. That's only if you're raising some exceptions just for portions. If you're raising an exception that applies to everything, that part's not necessary. And then again, send a copy of your written comments to the requester. I will note those comments to the requester. It's in 301E-1. If in your comments you have to reveal what's at issue in the information, you are allowed to redact that out from the requester's copy. So if you're raising attorney-client privilege and you're trying to tell us that you spoke to your attorney about and you explained the subject matter, that information can be redacted out on the requester's copy. Not to ours, we actually need that information. So general rules for counting business days, because this is, again, one of those things that we think we know what we're doing as attorneys, and we're like, wait a minute, maybe everyone doesn't count like we do. So you receive the request today. Tomorrow is day one. So the first day is the first business day after you receive the request. So if the requester sends a request at 2 a.m. on Saturday morning, the request is considered received on Monday, and business day one is Tuesday. We're going to look at some examples. Received means when it is physically received, not when it's finally open or read. And so this is important. You know, when I talked about all that mail that my office gets, we have a procedure in place for, you know, yes, I'm allowed to take vacation. And if I do, someone's got to look. So it's when the governmental body received it, not it sat on my desk for a week and a half, and I finally decided to open it. Okay, it's still received when you received it, when that mail got to you. So So just again, be diligent about looking through the things that you receive. Saturdays, Sundays, and holidays don't count. Skeleton crew days and days the governmental body is closed don't count. And if you are briefing us and there is a skeleton crew day in there, be sure to tell us. And a question we get on the hotline a lot is, how do I know if it's a skeleton crew day? My answer to you is that you have to tell us that. You are the ones that need to tell us that our governmental body was operating on a skeleton crew that day. So for example, today's February 28th, well, this Thursday is a skeleton crew day for state agencies. It's Texas Independence Day, so March 2nd. So we are operating on a skeleton crew. That does not mean everyone else is operating on a, you know, it depends. If you celebrate those holidays, let us know. The same idea applies to inclement weather days, which we got a couple years ago. It became a real big issue. There was this week, especially up in North Texas, where every governmental body in that region was closed a different amount or portion of days. You know, governmental bodies that were right next to each other in the same city, one may have been closed two business days, one may have been closed one. If we are talking about inclement weather, if you opened late, so there was a snowstorm and you decided to open at noon, no one come in till noon, be safe. That counts as a full business day. There's no such thing in open records counting as partial business days. Okay, so just keep that in mind. I went through our easy example. We definitely want to do the easy one first. So we just have this up here. In this case, we received the request on Monday. As I said, day one is Tuesday. So we just count straight through, not counting the 7th or 8th, which are Saturday and Sunday. And then day 10 is going to be Monday the 16th. So that's the easy one. That's our easy example. So you can see if there are no holidays in between, yes, it's essentially 2 weeks later. However, we don't say 2 weeks for this reason. Here's our slightly more complicated example, where we received this request on December 8th in this case. So the 19th is business day one. That's really easy. Day two, 21st and 22nd, well, that's Saturday and Sunday, we're not counting those. The 23rd, okay, that's day three. But then in this case, the state was closed for 3 days for Christmas and then had a skeleton crew on that Friday. So none of those days count. Neither does Saturday or Sunday. So you have day four isn't until the 30th of December. And going through with New Year's, we're half skeleton. So I know I said half days don't count, but in this case, it's a half skeleton, half holiday. So it's at least a skeleton crew for all part of the day. But if it had been half open, half holiday, that would have counted as a business day. So anyway, in this little more complicated example, we received the request on December 18th, and we don't get to day 10 until December 9th. And so we're gonna go over a little bit of the briefing. But again, if this is your holiday schedule and you do have to brief us for a discretionary exception, be sure to tell us. It is always better, sort of along the lines of what Jenny was talking about with open meetings. It is, more information is better. Because trust me, if my drafting attorneys have to guess if you're open on the 27th or not, don't make them guess. You going back to slide one, when we presume openness, trust me, you don't want to make them guess. So, we put this up here at this spot in the slide because there's only two valid ways to submit information for an open records letter holding. By mail, well, I guess, or hand delivered or courier, any of you in Austin, or through our electronic filing system. While I can receive information related to complaints by email or fax, since I'm doing it informally, if you actually need to get ruling information, it's gotta be done through one of those two methods. And so this is just, if you go to texas.gov, this is what the system will look like. And so we put that up there just to make sure everyone's aware of that option. If you are on day 10, and it's now 8 o'clock at night and you're trying to submit something to us. Okay, so all those things that I just told you to do, What's the consequence if you don't do them? If you don't request a ruling time, you received a request and you didn't timely request a ruling. So, mandatory exceptions are not waived. And we want to put that out there. Mandatory exceptions are typically going to be exceptions that protect other people. Permissive exceptions, however, which are typically going to be your exceptions that only protect the governmental body, those are waived. So, if you didn't properly and timely request a ruling and give me all that information, you may have waived those permissive exceptions. And so, we put in that the public information handbook, which is available on our website, and I think most of you now got at least a copy of the CD per agency, that has a little bit further discussion about that. And then, this is one of those slides as attorneys we put in here. It's by no means all of the ways you can mess up, but some of the ways you can mess up and not get us everything. So, the first one, pretty easy. You just didn't request a ruling by day 10. Like I said, you didn't read your mail until day 12, and you're now past your deadline. The next one, you failed to raise all the exceptions. So, even if, by the 10th day, even if you sent us the letter by day 10, and you said, we want to raise section 552.101 and 117, like I said, and then on day 12 you realize, oh yeah, we wanted to also raise 103. Well, you were timely on the first two exceptions, but not 103. So just be sure in that first letter you're including any exception you may want to raise. You sent everything to us, but you didn't notify the requester. And we do get comments from requesters to rulings, letting us know that, hey, I haven't heard from the governmental body. We have a ruling pending. And then they'll send in comments. And by not notifying them properly, you would have waived your exceptions. Again, not giving us the information. You'll see, if you feel like reading some rulings on our website, where we tell people that we can't rule on information that we can't see. So yes, you raised all these exceptions and provided all these comments, but you didn't give us the actual information for us to look at to see if that exception that you raised applied. And then again, just not submitting a copy of the request. So again, it's sort of, 301 is a good checklist. Anytime you're sending something to us, go back to that section, just go through, make sure you submitted all of that. These, we're not gonna go into these in depth at all today, but it's just to make you aware, sort of like with the personnel file, of some of the most commonly raised exceptions. Just the handbook, again, that everyone's got a copy of, has all of them, but these are some of the most common. So information confidential by law. The important thing to know about that exception 101, you're never gonna raise 101 by itself. 101 is raised in conjunction with another statute or law. So with the personnel file, I use the example of 101 in conjunction with common law privacy. So you may have medical information in a personnel file. So you would raise 101 in conjunction with either common law privacy, or if you actually had a doctor's note or record, potentially Medical Practices Act. But again, that section is always going to be raised with something else. Certain personnel information, so that title is slightly misleading. What we withhold under 102 for your purposes, there's something else that applies to school districts, but is going to be dates of birth of employees or what's withheld under there. 103, which I mentioned briefly earlier, information related to litigation. We have 104, that's going to apply to those bidding situations that I mentioned, where you maybe took bids on a project. 107, that's your attorney-client privilege. 108 is law enforcement records. Most likely not applicable to you guys. There may be an exception if you have a copy of a report or something as a proper custodian, but we're not going to go into that. 110 is trade secret. 111, that's work product or potentially drafts of memos. So if you have a draft of a policy memo that you are going to release the final version to the public, that's where that may apply. 117, we had mentioned certain employee information. 130, 136, 137, and 147. I went through those last ones really quick because we're going to cover them a little more in a second. So the next section we're going to look at in the, now I'm giving you another exception to everything I just told you, is section 552.022. This is information that we call core public information. And what the legislature has said about this information is that it's so important for the public to know this information that even if you raised everything timely and you did everything I just told you to do, you still can't withhold it unless it's a confidentiality provision. And so some examples of that, you're going to see the type of thing. It's most of the examples deal with the expenditure and receipt of the public's money. Again, you can see why the legislature would think that's pretty important if you're out there actually spending the public's money. But completed report, audit, or evaluation, the name, sex, ethnicity, salary, title, and dates of employment of each employee, information and account voucher contract relating to the exceed or expenditure of funds, working papers, see attorney fee bills. So your attorney fee bills, we would never withhold them in their entirety. We always mark, you know, if they actually reveal some attorney-client privilege information, we would mark it, but just know those are never going to be withheld in their entirety. Information in a court record, and then a settlement agreement. Again, don't call me and tell me you don't have access to your own settlement agreement. So again, as you can see, when we're talking about this core public information or 022 information, it really is not information that you would want. It's information that should be public. It's information the legislature has said is very important. So, I know I said that you don't need a ruling unless there's a previous determination. Now I'm going to tell you there's another exception. And this is an exception that the legislature added a couple sessions ago. If the information falls into one of these exceptions, then you can redact it without requesting a ruling as long as you follow the rules. And the rules are there is a specific form, and that form is on our website, that you would give the requester, and the requester then has the right to appeal it to us. And so 130, and these are all, again, just like the other previous determinations we discussed, should be things you can easily identify. So 130, driver's license number, motor vehicle title or registration, or personal identification. So raise your hand if you think you can identify a license plate or driver's license number in a document. So if you had a document with a license plate number, this is what I'm asking about, you could redact it without requesting a ruling. And this should be easily identifiable, okay? 136, that's gonna be your credit card, debit card, and access device numbers. So this is, you have a request for a bank statement. On your bank statement, you have your governmental body's account number. You can release the information to the requester, redacting that account number if you give the requester the proper form without going through the whole ruling process. And then 024, 1175, and 138, that deals with some of the personnel information we were talking about earlier. So it's going to be the employee's home address and phone number, whether they have family member information, an emergency contact, and social security. If they have elected for it to be public, private. So also in the handbook that everyone received, that form is at the back. There's an example of that form. So make sure that your employees and officers have made that election. And so here's where on our website you would find these forms. So I know it's kind of small, but it's down here at the bottom. You would go to the section on open government and you have those forms. What you don't want to do is, if assuming you don't want to talk to me on the enforcement side, you don't want to take one of those forms and change the numbers to another exception. They only apply to the ones we've actually published. And so that is important. We've only published those exceptions because those are the only ones that the statute allows you to do that for. So this flowchart here is everything we've talked about in just a different visual form so that everyone can see. You received the request, you have a presumption of openness. Then you either release the information, seek a decision, or rely on a previous determination. If you request a ruling, then that's where it goes down the middle. My office has 45 business days to issue that ruling. And then we're going to either tell you that you must withhold the information, meaning you have no choice to release it, you must withhold it. You may withhold it, and some information must be released. Sorry, you may not withhold it, and it must be released, or you may withhold it. And those are, again, it's just a flowchart. That's, you're going to ask for a ruling, and we're going to tell you one of three things. So after requesting a ruling, this just goes into, they are issued within 45 business days. We do get out many of those rulings much faster. We, even with doing 28,000, we try to get you an answer as soon as possible. In rare cases, we may ask for an additional 10 business days on this statute, and that is going to be in a case where maybe we have additional questions for you, or love that we're in legislative session now, because sometimes there may be new laws that we may need additional time to evaluate. And then again, I've said that multiple times, they're all on our website. Challenging a ruling. So requests for reconsideration are prohibited. So you get our ruling back, you don't like our ruling, we're not going to change it just because you don't like it. If a governmental body does disagree with it, the way to challenge it would be no later than the 30th calendar day to file a lawsuit. And that's in the act. So now we're going to go into, with the few minutes I have left, the portion where everything didn't go like it was supposed to. Like I said, this is the enforcement part of my job. There are three sort of separate routes for enforcement. There's this formal complaint under 3215 and mandamus. There's the informal complaints that we handle prior to filing mandamus. And then there is also criminal actions, just like open meetings. So under 3215, this is a complaint if someone disagreed with the way you were handling their requests, that they would have to first file with the local prosecutor. Local prosecutor has a time period in which they can decide whether or not they want to do anything, and then the requester can come to us. The other is a writ of mandamus. In this case, it's essentially us filing a lawsuit to force you to either request a ruling or release the information. And this case can be filed either by the requester directly against you. There's some recently in the news where the requester has done just that. You know, on day 11 has gone and filed a writ of mandamus. Or my office can do that. And then these are the criminal penalties that apply. So we have failure or refusal to provide access to or copying of the information. And if you fail to do so, it's a fine and or county jail of not more than 6 months, and it's a misdemeanor. Also important to note in these, and we have that on there for a reason, is it does constitute official misconduct. And that's sort of serious, especially if you want to go forward with government work. It is an affirmative defense, however. So say you did get a prosecutor who filed that action against you. It is an affirmative defense that you had a reasonable belief that public access to the information was not required, and you relied on a court order, a court opinion, or our decision. So if you actually requested a ruling, and we told you, then that's an affirmative defense in that case. Also an affirmative defense if you sought a decision, but one hasn't been issued yet. So you're in that 45 days, and again, someone decides they're going to try to file criminal action against you. Okay, destruction, removal, or alteration of public information. So this is a case, not where you're not releasing it, but you got the request and decided, instead of releasing it, to destroy it. Don't do that. And again, it's a separate offense in this case. And then fine and or jail time also. That's a misdemeanor. Distribution or misuse of confidential information. So this is the opposite. This is where I just said some information is confidential, like dates of birth, employee information. This is where instead of getting a ruling or instead of redacting that information, you just decided, I'm just going to go ahead and release it. I don't care. And so again, there's a fine of not more than $1,000 in county jail time and or county jail time, and also official misconduct. So this is for the question I got at the very beginning. This is all I'm going into cost in this presentation. And this is just to make you aware that if you were at the very beginning point of, we received a large request and we know we can charge because this is going to take all week to do. My short advice, do a sample test, get a good idea of the numbers. and then go to our website, where under the Open Government tab again, you're gonna find, it's called the Public Information Cost Estimate Model. So all of these little bullet points up here, if you clicked yes, there are labor charge, it'll expand. And it's essentially a fill in the blank. It will get you to a letter, it will generate the letter that the statute says you have to send to the requester if it's more than $40. Just keep that in mind. And as Jenny mentioned earlier, here are hotlines again. We do have one specifically for the cost. On most days you will get me, but there are a couple other attorneys as well. And so I said, we end with both of these because we do want you to know. Yes, we're out here training you, but if you have a question and come across weird situations, just give us a call and we will definitely help. Like I said, 9,000 calls last year. We're there. But yeah, thank you. We'll be around for a few minutes. If anyone has any questions, you can go to your break.
Anyone have any questions?
Oh, okay. Yes, she was asking. Yes, she was asking about the form that I said to fill out if you wanted your personal information withheld. We have that example. You don't have to use that. It's essentially an election. And the way it looks is it says, do you want your, if it's done properly, you know, it says phone number, address, it lists them out, and it's a yes or no, do you want them withheld if we get a request? And so if you have never done that, go do that. If you've done it and it's been several years, some of you that have been here longer or have employees that did it several years ago, keep in mind the legislature has added things. The most recent addition was emergency contact information. So you may need to update those. Because even if they filled out an election 10 years ago, they wouldn't have had the option to elect for that information. And so it's on our website and I believe in the back of the handbook as well, on the disc that we give out. And like I said, it's a sample. You can make it however you want it. Absolutely.
Thank you, Tamara. Let's give her a hand. I mean, she had a lot of information about herself. And do it in an hour's time. Okay, folks, let's take a 15-minute break. Be back in here.